Tanter Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Lincoln and His Admirals by Craig L. Symonds, narrated by David Vries. Introduction. This is an audiobook about the emergence and growth of Abraham Lincoln as a wartime commander-in-chief. To illustrate that evolution, it focuses on Lincoln's relationship with and management of the United States Navy. In the middle of the last century, the historian T. Harry Williams published a book entitled Lincoln and His Generals. In it, he posited that Lincoln was a great natural strategist, a better one than any of his generals. Most of those generals do not fare well at Williams's hand. Though he had some good things to say about Grant and Sherman, his scorn for the likes of Ambrose Burnside, Joseph Hooker, William S. Rosencrantz, and Don Carlos Buell is palpable, and he reserved his most vitriolic condemnations for the erstwhile young Napoleon, George B. McClellan. In part, no doubt, this was because McClellan was, and is, an easy target. But in addition, Williams was offended by McClellan's dismissive treatment of the president, including Little Mac's private references to Lincoln as the original guerrilla. Williams began his work by declaring that, "I have written in this book the story of Abraham Lincoln, the commander-in-chief." But that is only partly true, for he did not include any discussion of Lincoln's relationship with the Navy. Indeed, there is only one entry for the Navy in his index, and it is Navy, United States, and McClellan, for which there is but a single-page reference. Other scholars since then have tried their hand at assessing Lincoln's role as commander-in-chief, but none of them paid any serious attention to the naval war. When he took office in March 1861, navies and naval matters were utterly foreign to Lincoln. Yet as president, he would preside over the development and deployment of the largest naval force in American history to date, a force that would not be eclipsed in size or number until the emergence of the gray steel armadas of the World Wars. From virtually the first day of his presidency, when he had to consider dispatching a naval expedition to rescue the garrison of Fort Sumter, Lincoln was compelled to become a student of naval warfare. At least some of his education took place at the Washington Navy Yard. Barely a week after the fall of Sumter, Abraham and Mary Lincoln visited the Navy Yard to view the body of Lincoln's young friend, Elmer Ellsworth, shot dead after hauling down a Confederate flag from the roof of a hotel in Alexandria. 2 weeks later, Lincoln was at the Navy Yard again, this time to enjoy a concert of martial tunes by the band of the 71st Pennsylvania Regiment. From that day until virtually his last day as president, which was also his last day on Earth, the Navy Yard was one of the places, along with the War Department Telegraph Office, that he visited regularly. He became a close friend of the Yard's commandant, Commander, later Rear Admiral, John A. Dahlgren, and he often arrived there unannounced, sometimes with a friend or cabinet member, sometimes with his wife, sometimes alone, to witness the test firing of one or another new weapon, or simply to get away from the White House for a few hours. Besides Dahlgren, Lincoln was also tutored in his naval education by his earnest, candid, and often cranky Secretary of the Navy, Gideon Welles, and by Welles's efficient and ambitious Assistant Secretary, Gustavus Vaza Fox. Though he had a steep learning curve, Lincoln was a quick student. His early missteps during the Fort Sumter crisis and in managing the blockade were soon eclipsed by his active and efficient intervention in the war on the oceans, along the coast, and on the western rivers. As in his dealings with his generals, he sometimes found that his early trust in the Navy's top leaders was misplaced, and he had to make changes. Moreover, the lack of an established protocol for Army-Navy cooperation compelled him to insert himself in the planning and execution of combined operations. From the beginning, Lincoln's management of the serial crises of his administration was characterized by remarkable patience. He was often willing to let events determine not only the timing of his decisions, but also the decisions themselves. This is what he meant when he famously remarked late in the war, "I claim not to have controlled events, but confess plainly that events have controlled me." Though Lincoln had several fixed stars in his ideology, opposition to slavery in every form being among the brightest, he did not embark on his presidency with a list of predetermined objectives or goals other than the preservation of the Union. He had no 100-day program of reform in mind, and given the speed of events as he encountered them, he was, from the very outset, thrown into a reactive mode rather than a proactive one. From his consideration of what to do about Fort Sumter to his program for Reconstruction, Lincoln regularly adopted a wait-and-see attitude in responding to the multiple and various crises of his unprecedented administration. His genius derived more from what might be labeled inspired patience than from insistent direction. When he did act, Lincoln demonstrated that he was unwilling to be hamstrung by established doctrine. He believed in a government strong enough to maintain itself and far-reaching enough to serve the people as a whole, not merely some privileged segment of it. Because the Civil War created an unprecedented number of problems for government to solve, it provided Lincoln with an equally unprecedented number of opportunities to exercise his pragmatic approach to problem-solving. In nearly every crisis, he sought solutions unfettered by concerns about how it had always been done before, or even by conventional limitations on government authority. Lincoln was no scofflaw. As both a lawyer and a statesman, he revered the law, and especially the Constitution. But he did not believe that a reverence for the law should justify inaction or tolerate injustice. Laws were created to serve the needs of the whole country, and when they ceased to do that, Lincoln believed that those laws should be replaced by new ones. Intelligent and responsible men of goodwill could and should find ways to do the things that would benefit society. In short, Lincoln's fundamental pragmatism led him to seek new and creative ways to fulfill what he conceived of as his sacred responsibility. A third factor in Lincoln's makeup that proved critical to his success as a wartime president was his willingness to embrace not just new ideas, but new technologies. Soon after he took office, Lincoln confessed to Welles, "I know but little about ships." But his was a naturally creative mind that could bend itself to the solution of all sorts of issues. He may not have been a naval expert, but he was fascinated by gadgets. During the Civil War, he became interested in the gadgetry of warfare, and not incidentally naval warfare, as demonstrated by his frequent escapes to the Navy Yard to witness and occasionally participate in the testing of new weapons. Eventually, he would become an advocate, and a knowledgeable one, of heavy-caliber naval guns, armored warships, floating mortar platforms, and other elements of the revolution in naval ordnance that took place simultaneously with the Civil War. Indeed, given the innate conservatism of many senior naval officers, it sometimes took Lincoln's gentle prodding to get them to accept and employ the new technology. As he grew comfortable in holding the reins of power, Lincoln became more assertive as commander-in-chief. In 1861, he hoped that Winfield Scott would manage the armed forces with as little oversight as possible. By 1862, he was beginning to exercise hands-on management, even issuing operational orders to division commanders. And by 1863, he was hitting his full stride as an activist commander-in-chief. As tentative as he was early on, he eventually became one of the most audacious of all American chief executives, authorizing a blockade and approving a conscription law, paper money, an income tax, and, most revolutionary of all, emancipation. Then, once he found military leaders whom he trusted to fulfill his strategic vision, he retreated once again from his activist role and delegated military questions to his uniformed commanders while he focused on the larger question of how to reconstruct a post-war America once the bloodshed ended. While Lincoln has been admired and extolled for these accomplishments by later generations, his early missteps are often ignored or overlooked. It is curious that conventional explanations of Abraham Lincoln emphasize his astonishing trajectory from humble roots to the presidency without acknowledging that his progress continued into and during his term in office. Lincoln's first-term vice president, Hannibal Hamlin, believed that Lincoln's Eulogists make the mistake of constructing a Lincoln who was as great the day he left Springfield as when he made his earthly exit 4 years later. Such a deification of Lincoln does him a disservice, since it assumes that Lincoln's mastery of the great national trauma of Civil War came to him easily and naturally. It did not. In 1861, Lincoln was not a great commander-in-chief, a fact he freely acknowledged. By 1865, he had become the greatest in American history. Hamlin concluded that no man ever grew in the executive chair in his lifetime as Lincoln did. One of the themes of this audiobook is to demonstrate not only how Lincoln managed the Navy, and particularly its admirals, during its great national trauma, but also how, and how much, he grew in the job during his metamorphosis into greatness. This is also, and necessarily, an audiobook about Lincoln's admirals. Though Lincoln did not have to deal with political admirals in the same way he did political generals, there was, nevertheless, a political dimension to managing their activities. The Civil War was the first conflict in which American naval leaders bore the rank of admiral, and they were a mixed lot, from the stolid and reliable David Glasgow Farragut to his boisterous and self-confident foster brother David Dixon Porter, from the touchy and aristocratic Samuel Francis DuPont to the flamboyant and confrontational Charles Wilkes, and from the meticulous and careful Samuel Phillips Lee to the ambitious ordnance expert John A. Dahlgren, the presidential friend who desperately wanted command at sea despite a debilitating tendency to seasickness, a predilection that Lincoln shared. Collectively, but not always harmoniously, these men commanded the largest navy ever assembled by the United States. This is not, however, a history of the Civil War Navy. Operational history is included only when it helps explain the context for the problems and issues that made their way to Lincoln's desk. Finally, two of the key characters in the story are Lincoln's Navy Secretary, Gideon Welles, and the Assistant Secretary, Gustavus Fox. Welles was open and honest with Lincoln, politically adept and yet disarmingly straightforward. He was by turns blunt, challenging, cantankerous, and tiresomely earnest. He was protective of his commander-in-chief and jealous of the influence exercised on him by others, especially Secretary of State William Henry Seward. For his part, Fox was a former naval officer turned businessman whom Lincoln adopted during the Fort Sumter crisis and for whom he created the post of Assistant Secretary. During the war, Fox was often the intermediary between Lincoln and his admirals and operated as a kind of chief of naval operations. On many issues, Lincoln left the management of the Navy to Welles, Fox, and the admirals. But just as he was forced to do in the land war, he found that it was necessary to intervene when naval operations touched upon legal, political, diplomatic, financial, or other issues of national moment. In doing so, Lincoln demonstrated not only his native intelligence and his remarkable patience, but also his keen political sensitivity, his deft touch as a manager, his willingness to make a hard call and assume full responsibility for the consequences, and, throughout it all, despite personal and national tragedy that could easily have broken him, his humor and his humanity. 1861. Getting Underway. 1. What have I done wrong? Lincoln and the Fort Sumter Crisis. In the tension-filled weeks leading up to his inauguration, Abraham Lincoln probably spent little time thinking about the U.S. Navy. After all, the handful of vessels showing the flag on widely scattered overseas stations was an unlikely instrument in the secession crisis, which was grounded in a sectional dispute about the expansion of slavery into the Western territories. Lincoln had been president for barely 24 hours, however, when he read a report from Major Robert Anderson, commander of beleaguered Fort Sumter in the middle of Charleston Harbor. For more than 2 months, Anderson had written near-daily reports to Washington describing his garrison's increasing isolation and vulnerability. In reply, he had received little from the lame duck Buchanan administration beyond orders to do nothing to disturb the public peace. Meanwhile, South Carolina and later Confederate authorities had constructed artillery batteries all around the harbor, literally surrounding his small command. Now, in a letter dated February 28 and carefully marked as number 58, Anderson reported not only that he was running out of supplies, but also, far worse, that it would require an army of at least 20,000 well-trained soldiers to deliver the supplies he needed. The news was a bombshell, for as Anderson surely understood, in asking for 20,000 men, he might as well have asked for 20 million. The entire U.S. Army, scattered in 79 forts and outposts across half a continent, numbered barely 17,000. In effect, what Anderson was telling the new president was that the men in Fort Sumter could not stay where they were without immediate support, and that the support they needed was beyond the power of the government. It was a devastating challenge to Lincoln's policy. Just the day before, in his inaugural address, the new president had pledged himself to hold, occupy, and possess government property in the seceded states. His plan was to cling to the federal posts in the South to preserve the principle of national unity while avoiding any provocative act that might drive the wavering border states out of the Union. He hoped that this combination of resolve and restraint might create an opportunity for the latent unionism that he still believed to exist in the South to assert itself. Anderson's gloomy report, however, suggested that Lincoln must now choose, and soon, between two equally undesirable options. He must either evacuate Anderson's garrison from Fort Sumter and begin his administration with a craven act of surrender, or commit a provocative act that not only was sure to alienate the border states, but also was likely to fail. Alarmed, Lincoln consulted the country's most senior general, Winfield Scott, who confirmed Anderson's estimate. Indeed, Scott suggested that, if anything, Anderson had understated the case. Sending supplies to Fort Sumter meant sending ships into Charleston Harbor. The fort, after all, sat on an island. But, Scott declared, no ship could enter the harbor until the hostile shore batteries had been captured or suppressed. To do that, it would be necessary to conduct large-scale amphibious landings on both Morris Island and Sullivan's Island, and those landings must then be followed by lengthy sieges. Not only would such a campaign require more men than the U.S. Army possessed, it would take more time than Anderson had. Still, in the end, Scott acknowledged that the question was one for naval authorities to decide. Scott's deference to the Navy was not merely a courtesy. In the 19th century, the Department of War and the Department of the Navy were separate and independent branches of government. Though Scott had been a general for nearly half a century, almost as long as Lincoln had been alive, he could not give orders concerning the Navy, nor could any naval officer, no matter how senior, give orders to the Army. Consequently, as valuable as Scott's advice might be, at some point Lincoln would have to seek the Navy's views, and that meant talking with his new Secretary of the Navy, Gideon Welles. Welles was one of only two cabinet members, Secretary of State William H. Seward being the other, to hold his job throughout Lincoln's administration. Eventually, Lincoln would come to rely on Welles's loyalty and honesty as well as his passion, but Welles had obtained his position in the first place mainly because of political geography. The Republican Party was a patchwork quilt of Free Soilers, anti-Nebraska Democrats, conscience Whigs, and know-nothings, and Lincoln sought to include representatives from each faction in his cabinet. In addition, it was traditional for the cabinet to include at least one individual from each section of the country. There was no shortage of former Whigs from New York and the Midwest, but what Lincoln needed, as he wrote to Vice President-elect Hannibal Hamlin, was a man of Democratic antecedents from New England. Welles was both a former Democrat and a politician of proven skill in his home state of Connecticut, where he had been an influential publisher and the postmaster of Hartford, an important position in terms of local patronage, and he had the support of the vice president, who, as a Maine man, was expected to have some influence in the naming of the New England member of the cabinet. Welles fit the political requirements, but it was not clear which job in the cabinet he would be asked to fill. Until the very day that Lincoln sent his name to the Senate, Welles thought he was likely to be named Postmaster General. Instead, that job went to Montgomery Blair, in acknowledgment of his family's considerable influence in both Maryland and Missouri, and Welles ended up as Secretary of the Navy. Although Welles had legitimate expertise in naval matters, including a term as Chief of the Bureau of Provisions and Clothing under President Polk, the only civilian ever to hold such a post, the appointment was not popular in all quarters. Seward, the new Secretary of State, whom many insiders expected to dominate the administration, was disappointed, even annoyed by it. The gaunt Seward and the comfortably plump Welles not only were different physically, but had vastly different personal styles. Seward had been the titular head of the Republican Party almost since its founding, and carried himself with a restrained gravitas that befitted a great statesman. Welles was more excitable, tended to speak his mind, and generally allowed his expressive face to mirror his strongly held opinions. Moreover, the urbane Seward found Welles not only annoyingly voluble, but also unsophisticated, even comical. The 59-year-old Welles wore a wig that he had purchased years before when his hair was still light brown and only tinged with gray. He continued to wear that same wig as a cabinet secretary, even though his beard was now snowy white and the contrast was jarring. Moreover, Welles tended to wear his wig like a hat, plunking it on his head in the morning without paying serious attention to how it rested on his balding dome, and pushing it back on his head absent-mindedly as he worked at his desk. If he sneezed or shook his head violently, the wig skittered about independently. Seward's political adviser, Thurlow Weed, shared his chief's disdain for Welles. Though he had supported the appointment, mainly for reasons of political balance, he subsequently suggested to Lincoln that if the president really wanted an attractive figurehead to be adorned with an elaborate wig and luxuriant whiskers, he could easily transfer it from the prow of a ship to the entrance of the Navy Department, and it would be quite as serviceable as the incumbent. The president fended off this indecorous jibe with his typical goodwill and humor. "Oh," he replied, "wooden midshipmen answer very well in novels, but we must have a live Secretary of the Navy." If Seward and his supporters dismissed Welles as a bit ludicrous, Welles thought Seward too cunning and manipulative. In his journal, he routinely called him the trickster. While he admired Seward's talents, he suspected his motives. Welles acknowledged that the Secretary of State was a man of restless activity and unceasing labors, but he distrusted Seward's showy manifestations and sometimes incautious exercise of questionable authority. Welles believed that Seward was a political animal whose talents were more versatile than profound, and who had no great or original conceptions of right nor systematic ideas of administration. The tension between the two men would affect how Lincoln managed the Fort Sumter crisis, and indeed the war that followed. Both men were present at the first full cabinet meeting of the Lincoln administration on March 9, when the president shared Anderson's alarming report. After the assembled cabinet ministers expressed their shock and surprise, most of them instinctively declared that Anderson must be resupplied. If the secessionists were successful in driving the American flag from the national forts, the government might as well acquiesce in a divided country. Lincoln had asked General Scott to attend as well, and after the cabinet members had expressed their determination and resolve, Scott patiently instructed them about the military realities that made a successful relief expedition to Fort Sumter impossible. The 74-year-old Scott had brought along reinforcements in the form of the Army's 73-year-old chief engineer, General Joseph Totten. Between them, Scott and Totten had more than a century of military experience, and their opinions were not to be taken lightly. Their testimony did not impress Montgomery Blair, however, who was adamant that Fort Sumter must not be surrendered at any cost or any sacrifice. A West Point graduate himself, Blair was an old-fashioned Jacksonian nationalist who believed that the current crisis was the result of insufficient firmness on the part of the national government. his mutton-chop sideburns framed a face dominated by close-set dark eyes and a sharp nose that gave him a belligerent look to match his mood. The time had come, he insisted, when the government should assert its power and authority. In the midst of Blair's blustering, Seward stepped forward to establish his leadership in the cabinet and in the administration by offering a solution. Seward's unstated objective was to do whatever was necessary to ward off a confrontation for a few crucial months, at the end of which, he was convinced, cooler heads would prevail in the South and a counter-revolution would take place. To accomplish this, he had to prevent Lincoln from taking any precipitate action in Charleston. The evacuation of Sumter, he now declared, was apparently inevitable. The unimpeachable testimony of the military experts made that clear. But the political cost of such a move could be mitigated by shifting public attention away from Fort Sumter to Fort Pickens, off the Gulf Coast of Florida, near Pensacola. It, too, was a federal fort built by the Army Corps of Engineers. It, too, was being held by a small federal garrison threatened by noisy militia forces who insisted that it be turned over to them. The difference was that Pickens was not completely surrounded by hostile batteries. The government could therefore make a public show of reinforcing Fort Pickens, where the local geography made such an effort relatively simple, while quietly evacuating Fort Sumter, where geography and circumstance made it impossible. As Lincoln himself put it later, the reinforcement of Pickens would be a clear indication of policy and would better enable the country to accept the evacuation of Fort Sumter as a military necessity. It was not a perfect solution, but it was better than simple capitulation. Not everyone in the room believed that the rescue of Fort Sumter was so hopeless as to require looking elsewhere for a political fig leaf. Blair continued to hammer away at the symbolic importance of Sumter, and Welles disputed the conclusion that a naval relief expedition there was impossible. Welles had brought along an expert of his own, in the form of 63-year-old Commodore Silas Stringham, who could point to 52 years of naval service, thanks to the fact that he had accepted a midshipman's warrant at the age of 11. Stringham testified that a relief expedition to Sumter was not at all impracticable. In fact, he had championed two separate plans to resupply the fort back in January, one proposed by Commander James H. Ward and another by a former Navy lieutenant named Gustavus Vaza Fox. Each man had a friend at court. Ward had been a boyhood friend of Gideon Welles, and Fox was Montgomery Blair's brother-in-law. Their plans were similar in several important ways. Ward suggested using small Treasury Department steamers, revenue cutters, to run supplies into Fort Sumter at night, and Fox argued for doing much the same thing using New York City tugboats. To Lincoln's question whether such a plan could work, Scott acknowledged that either plan would almost certainly have worked if executed back in January when they had first been proposed, or perhaps even in February, but he insisted that it was now too late. The harbor defenses were just too strong. Though Scott and Stringham were carefully deferential to each other, a vast gulf divided them. Conventional wisdom held that, as the New York Tribune had recently declared, ships are no match for land batteries. That assumption governed Scott's and Totten's advice. As the Army's chief engineer, who had supervised the construction of many of the nation's coastal forts, including Sumter, Totten was a champion of their effectiveness, and he insisted that even modest land batteries could easily dispatch any naval expedition. Stringham did not respond directly to Totten's lengthy dissertation, but his silence was eloquent. As Attorney General Edward Bates noted in his diary, the Army officers and Navy officers differ widely about the degree of danger to rapidly moving vessels passing under the fire of land batteries. The Army officers think destruction almost inevitable, where the Navy officers think the danger slight. Without choosing between the Army and the Navy, Lincoln saw that the Ward-Fox plan offered at least the possibility that Anderson could be sustained at Fort Sumter without risking either a direct provocation or a humiliating repulse. If so, It would not only buy time, but also might shift the burden of decision-making from Washington back onto the secessionists. Seward dismissed the idea. He noted that the previous administration had erred by sending the unarmed steamer Star of the West into Charleston in January, only to see it driven off after being struck twice by shots from shore. If the government now tried to support Anderson by sending New York City tugboats to Charleston and the effort failed, which was almost certain, the new administration would appear ridiculous. Better not to try at all, he maintained, than to try with insufficient force and fail. Besides, even if the effort succeeded, it would infuriate the border states, a primary concern of both Lincoln and Seward. Until shots were fired, there was always a chance that the sectional schism could be resolved short of open conflict. Nevertheless, Lincoln was interested enough to ask Welles to flesh out the Ward Fox plan, and he told Scott to invite both men to Washington to present their plans in person. In the meantime, the government could ensure the safety of Fort Pickens in Florida by landing the 100 or so men that had been sent there more than a month before on board the USS Brooklyn and who had been bobbing uselessly off Pensacola ever since. This fell far short of the grand public gesture that Seward wanted in order to redirect the nation's attention away from Sumter, but it would, quite literally, hold the fort. In spite of the ticking clock, Lincoln refused to be rushed. As Welles expressed it, Lincoln was disinclined to hasty action and wished time for the administration to get in working order before committing to a particular policy. Not everyone agreed that a decision could be postponed. Montgomery Blair remained adamant in his support for immediate action. 2 days later, on March 11, Blair's father, Francis Blair Sr., all but forced his way into Lincoln's office to lecture the president on the symbolic importance of holding Fort Sumter. A former member of Andrew Jackson's kitchen cabinet and publisher of the influential Globe, the elder Blair had been one of the founders of the Republican Party. He was also prone to fits of temper. On this occasion, he became so exercised that he subsequently felt obliged to apologize for being impertinent. But Blair's passion had its impact. If Frank Blair saw Fort Sumter as a metaphor of national unity, so would others. Welles believed that Blair's visit aroused and electrified the president. If so, Lincoln still kept his options open. He was willing to listen to the naval experts, but he leaned toward evacuation. Certainly, the visit of Commander Ward did little to change his mind. Whatever enthusiasm Ward had once had for a relief mission to Charleston evaporated under the pointed questioning of Scott and Totten. Alerted to the nature of the new fortifications in Charleston Harbor, Ward now agreed that a nighttime relief mission was no longer practical. The next day, Montgomery Blair escorted Gustavus Vasa Fox into Lincoln's office. Fox was not particularly martial in appearance. He was of medium stature with a broad face, a high forehead, and dark, piercing eyes above a pear-shaped body. Montgomery Blair's sharp-tongued sister routinely referred to him in her private correspondence as Fatty. He combed his dark, thinning hair straight back, and though his cheeks were clean-shaven, he sported a drooping walrus mustache that blended into a luxuriant curling beard, cascading from his chin to his chest, giving him the appearance of a Chinese mandarin in a business suit. Though Fox had served as a naval officer for 15 years, including a circumnavigation of the globe in the early 1850s, he had left the Navy in 1853 to pursue more lucrative employment and was now a private citizen. Of course, he was also Blair's brother-in-law. Fox and Blair had each married a daughter of Andrew Jackson's Secretary of the Navy, Levi Woodbury, and that connection, as much as his naval expertise, gained Fox entry into Lincoln's office. Unlike Ward, Fox was convinced that his resupply scheme was still viable. Urged on by the younger Blair, he outlined it for the president. New York City tugboats, Fox explained, could be escorted to Charleston by the USS Pawnee and the revenue cutter Harriet Lane, practically the only ships readily available in America's tiny marine arsenal. The Pawnee could ascertain the strength of the secessionist batteries by approaching the harbor in daylight. If those batteries opened fire, the Pawnee would not challenge them. Instead, it would clear the channel of any secessionist gunboats, the only threat that Fox considered important. Meanwhile, the shallow draft tugs, loaded with both supplies and reinforcements, and with their machinery protected by two rows of cotton bales, would wait for the dark of night to run into the harbor at 14 knots to deposit their cargo on Fort Sumter's small wharf. It would be virtually impossible, Fox insisted, for secessionist batteries on Cummings Point or Sullivan's Island, each of them some three-quarters of a mile away, to hit such small, fast-moving targets at night. Lincoln saw some drawbacks to the scheme. First of all, it meant sending a warship to Charleston, and that would almost certainly be perceived as aggressive by the secessionists. Lincoln had promised in his inaugural that the government will not assail you. You can have no conflict without being yourselves the aggressors. If he ordered the Pawnee to Charleston Harbor and it used its guns to clear the channel of hostile vessels, just who was the aggressor? Perhaps sensing the president's wariness, Blair suggested that Lincoln could at least send Fox to Charleston to talk with Major Anderson and assess the situation there. Always willing to obtain more information, Lincoln agreed, though he made no commitment and was still leaning toward evacuation when he bade Fox farewell. Lincoln also wanted to know more about the political mood in South Carolina. Seward's argument for restraint was based on the assumption, which Lincoln shared, that a large percentage of the Southern population still bore an affection for the old Union and was simply being carried along by the emotion of the moment. Seward argued repeatedly that this latent Unionism might still assert itself if the administration refused to provoke the secessionists. Welles was skeptical. A friend from Tennessee had recently written him that enthusiasm for secession in the Cotton States was near universal, and that it was wishful thinking to assume that the majority are trampled down by the seceding minority. Just how much latent Unionism was there in South Carolina? To find out, Lincoln decided to send his friend and unofficial bodyguard, Ward Hill Lehman, to find out. On his own, Stephen A. Hurlbut, who had been born in Charleston before moving to Illinois in the 1840s, decided to go with him. As Fox, Lehman, and Hurlbut each traveled south on different missions, Lincoln met with his cabinet again, this time asking each man to commit his views regarding Fort Sumter to paper. This was an exercise he used regularly to clarify his own thoughts, and he hoped it would do the same for his advisors. Seward replied with a lengthy essay arguing that any attempt to relieve Sumter would be perceived as both aggressive and hostile by the loyal slave states at a time when they hovered precariously in the balance, and that even if the attempt were successful, an unlikely prospect, Sumter itself would be practically useless to the government. The result, Seward concluded, would be that we will have inaugurated a civil war by our own act, without an adequate object. His argument carried the day. Only Secretary of the Treasury Salmon P. Chase and the pugnacious Blair voted in favor of a resupply effort. Even Welles voted against it. Buoyed by the vote in the cabinet, Seward privately assured a trio of Confederate commissioners through an intermediary that the administration had decided to evacuate the fort. That intermediary, Supreme Court Justice John A. Campbell of Alabama, promised the rebel commissioners that Fort Sumter would be evacuated within the next 5 days and even signed an affidavit to that effect. Later, when Seward sensed that administration policy was shifting, he backtracked a bit, telling Campbell that if for any reason the government did try to resupply Sumter, it would at least send formal notification first. Fox left Washington on March 19 and traveled south by train through Virginia and the Carolinas, arriving in Charleston on March 21. Part of the way, he sat with former South Carolina Congressman Robert Holmes, who told everyone he saw that he had it on the highest authority that Fort Sumter was soon to be evacuated. At the time, Fox kept silent, though he later wondered if that information had not come from Seward via Justice Campbell. In Charleston, Fox met with South Carolina's governor, Francis Pickens, who agreed to let him go out to Fort Sumter and talk with Anderson if Fox would assure him that his visit was for peaceful purposes. With perhaps a qualm or two, Fox agreed. Rowed out to Sumter after nightfall, Fox found Anderson despondent. Even the news that the government had granted him 2 brevet promotions in recognition of his stalwart resistance could not dispel his gloom. Like his fellow Army professionals, Anderson believed that any naval expedition that attempted to force its way into the harbor was doomed. Eager to avoid open hostilities, he strongly opposed any effort to reinforce or supply him. To support his case, Anderson pointed out the silhouettes of the new fortifications on every side as he and Fox stood on the ramparts of Fort Sumter in the darkness. The Navy man, however, looked at the harbor defenses with different eyes and continued to believe that those batteries posed little threat to a small, fast-moving target at night. For him, the clincher came when the boat that had brought him out to Fort Sumter returned 2 hours later to ferry him back. Fox could hear the creak of oars in the oarlocks, but the boat remained virtually invisible from the fort's small pier until she almost touched the landing. If a small boat could not be seen from Fort Sumter at 20 feet, how could it be seen from Fort Moultrie at 3/4 of a mile? Fox returned to Washington on March 24, more convinced than ever that he could reinforce the garrison with men and supply it with provisions. A few days later, Lehman returned with his report. Neither he nor Hurlbut had been able to discover any evidence of unionism, latent or otherwise, in South Carolina. Only elderly Judge James Pettigrew, who had famously declared that South Carolina was too small to be a nation and too large to be an insane asylum, and who was tolerated in Charleston as a local crank, was exempt from the popular enthusiasm for the new secessionist government. This news suggested that restraint and forbearance were unlikely to cool the secessionist ardor or to encourage unionism. Lehman also reported that although Anderson was deeply despondent, he acknowledged that he could probably hold out until April 15 if necessary. These reports led Lincoln to consider a rescue mission to Fort Sumter more seriously. But what finally changed his mind was a disturbing memorandum from Scott, who offered an unsolicited assessment that the evacuation of Sumter would not be enough to ensure the allegiance of the Upper South. He now insisted that the government should evacuate both Sumter and Fort Pickens. The evacuation of both the forts, Scott declared, would instantly soothe and give confidence to the 8 remaining slaveholding states. Government firmness, Scott suggested, could still be demonstrated by clinging to Fort Taylor at Key West and Fort Jefferson in the isolated Dry Tortugas, which he said should never be abandoned. This gratuitous advice was well outside Scott's authority as commanding general, for it was based not on military circumstances, but his political judgment. Still, its contents gave Lincoln a cold shock. Indeed, Scott's recommendation was nearly as distressing as the letter Lincoln had received from Anderson more than 3 weeks before that first informed him of a problem. The public might eventually come to understand the imperative of military necessity as an explanation for the abandonment of Sumter, but Pickens was different. It was not under any immediate threat. To surrender both forts would signal a deliberate policy of accommodation, the same policy that had been pursued by Lincoln's discredited predecessor. Moreover, the absence of any latent unionism in South Carolina, reported by Hurlbut's and Scott's estimate that the evacuation of Sumter would do little to rekindle that unionism, suggested that a policy of restraint was unlikely to yield any tangible benefit. Here Lincoln's hope for a national reconciliation gave way before his determination to uphold his oath. After a sleepless night, he decided sometime on the morning of March 28 that he would hold both forts, and that meant he would have to authorize an expedition to provision Fort Sumter. The cumulative impact of Frank Blair's diatribe, Fox's confident enthusiasm, the reports from Hurlbut and Lehman, and Scott's unsolicited political advice each played a role. But the decision was Lincoln's alone. That evening, at a state dinner, the president quietly asked each of his cabinet members to stay behind for a brief word. With a serious expression and in solemn tones, he shared with them the contents of Scott's memorandum and told them he wanted them to meet with him the next day to make a final decision about Fort Sumter. At that meeting, Lincoln informed his advisers that he was now inclined to send an expedition to Sumter to reprovision Anderson's garrison, and, as he often did, he asked each of them to write a short response. Bates managed to sound both determined and undecided at the same time. "The time is come," he wrote, "either to evacuate or relieve it." Chase was more direct. He wanted to provision Sumter and to hold Pickens. Welles concurred in Lincoln's proposal to send an armed force off Charleston with supplies and provisions. He recognized that this might well lead to war, but noted that armed resistance to a peaceable attempt to send provisions to one of our own forts will justify the government in using all the powers at its command. Seward remained opposed to the end. Even if war eventually became necessary, he did not want a war to begin at Charleston. "I advise against the expedition in every view," he wrote. It was too late. Lincoln had made up his mind. 25 days after reading Anderson's alarming letter, he had determined to order a naval expedition to Charleston to resupply him. Seward had one more card to play. In his written response, the Secretary of State had urged the President to call in Captain M.C. Meigs forthwith. Whether Lincoln agreed to do so, or Seward simply acted on his own suggestion, that same afternoon, Seward brought Meigs to the White House. Seward declared that besides listening to senior generals such as Scott and Totten, they should also hear from an officer, in Seward's uncharitable words, who could get on a horse in the field. Meigs, at 44, was certainly capable of mounting a horse, and was in Washington at that time because he was supervising the construction of the new Capitol Dome. Seward had brought him to the White House to convince Lincoln that the expedition should be sent not to Sumter, but to Fort Pickens. Lincoln welcomed Meigs in his convivial way and asked him if Pickens could be saved. "Certainly," Meigs replied, "if the Navy has not lost it already." When asked by Lincoln if he could go down there and secure it, Meigs protested that he was only a captain and it would be inappropriate for him to have such a command. Seward thought that problem was easy to fix. "Captain Meigs, you have got to be promoted," he declared. Only with difficulty did Meigs convince the two civilians what a breach of military protocol that would be. As Lincoln mulled over the idea of sending a captain to command such a crucial expedition, Seward offered the president a parallel from history. When the British needed to reclaim Quebec, he noted, they did not send an aged and infirm senior commander, but the 32-year-old James Wolfe, whose victory had secured a continent. "Would the president do this now?" Seward asked. Lincoln agreed to consider it, but even if he did decide to send an expedition to Pickens, he was determined to send one to Sumter as well, and time was running out. Anderson had told Lehman that he could hold out only until April 15, and it was already March 29. Lincoln wanted the expedition to move by April 6. The test of the government now was not its willingness to make a decision, but its ability to pull together a combined operation quickly and efficiently. The wheels were turning at last, but the gears did not mesh. Instead, the last-minute effort to rescue Anderson's garrison was marked by confusion and inefficiency so profound that it led some to suspect treachery. For all his clarity of purpose, Lincoln's management of the Fort Sumter expedition demonstrated three things: that he had not yet taken the reins of authority firmly into his own hands, that his talented cabinet members had not yet melded into an efficient or even a competent team, and that the machinery of America's peacetime military establishment could not shift smoothly or easily into crisis mode. First, there was the question of who would command. Presumably, this would have to be a Navy man. Commodore Stringham was the logical choice, but he declined to assert his claim and because Fox had devised the plan and scouted the objective, Lincoln decided that Fox should command. Fox, however, was a private citizen, with no military standing or rank. As Scott put it in his orders, he was simply a gentleman of high standing. So while Fox might command the tugs and the supply vessel, he could not exercise command authority over the escorting Navy warships, which would necessarily be under the authority of Navy officers. Consequently, Fox's orders directed that if he encountered resistance at Charleston, he was to notify the senior officer of the harbor, who would use his entire force to open a passage. The orders did not name the senior officer largely because no one yet knew who it was going to be. Second, the ships had to be found and prepared. While Fox arranged to lease or charter the supply ships, Welles fired off telegrams to various Navy base commanders ordering them to prepare the warships that would accompany the expedition. These included the steam frigate Pocahontas at Norfolk, the Pawnee at Washington, and the revenue cutter Harriet Lane at New York. Fox had named these three in his plan simply because they were all that was available. Fox himself would ride the Baltic, a chartered civilian steamer that would carry Sumter supplies and the reinforcement of 200 soldiers. A day later, Welles added the USS Powhatan to the expedition. It had just returned from a long deployment off Veracruz, and Welles included it because it possessed the firepower to force the issue if that became necessary. Moreover, it could carry an additional number of small boats that might be used to help carry supplies to the fort. All these various ships, plus three New York City tugboats, were to put to sea independently and rendezvous 10 miles outside Charleston 11 days hence. Altogether, the United States was committing most of its available naval force to the expedition. In the administration's first important policy decision, Seward's arguments had failed to carry the day. His disappointment led him to dictate a remarkable document to his 31-year-old son, Frederick, who served as his secretary. Entitled Some Thoughts for the President's Consideration, it was delivered to Lincoln's hand on the morning of April 1, the same day that the orders to mobilize the expedition to Sumter went out from Welles's office. Whether he intended it as such, Seward's memorandum was a direct criticism, even a rebuke, of Lincoln's first month in office. Seward declared challengingly, "We are at the end of a month's administration and yet without a policy, either domestic or foreign." Uncharitable as this was, it was also mostly correct. Lincoln's preference to wait and see had cost the government precious time. There was nothing new in Seward's assertion that the government ought to divert public attention from the issue of slavery to one of national union. What was new was his suggestion that the United States should achieve this by questioning European intentions in the Western Hemisphere. He would demand that Spain, France, Great Britain, and Russia explain themselves, and he suggested that if those nations did not respond satisfactorily, it would be appropriate to declare war on them. Even if it did not lead to actual war, the crisis would, as Seward had explained to the British ambassador, divert the public excitement. Moreover, Seward declared in his note that it must be somebody's business to pursue and direct this policy. Either the president must do it himself or devolve it on some member of his cabinet. Lincoln deftly turned aside this clumsy challenge to his authority. He recognized at once that Seward's pique derived from the decision to reinforce Sumter, and he composed a reply in which he wrote, "I do not perceive how the reinforcement of Fort Sumter would be done on a slavery or party issue, while that of Fort Pickens would be on a national or a patriotic one. As for devolving authority on some member of the cabinet," Lincoln wrote that whatever must be done, I must do it, adding deliberate emphasis to the personal pronoun. He did not, however, deliver the letter to Seward. As he often did during his presidency, Lincoln answered his critic on paper, then quietly put the answer in a drawer. Very likely, Lincoln replied to Seward in person, perhaps, as his biographer Benjamin Thomas has suggested, in a quiet, heart-to-heart talk. If so, Seward was not chastened. Later that same day, he returned to the White House with Meigs in tow, hoping to revive his plan to reinforce Pickens. This time, he also brought along a dark-bearded Navy officer named David Dixon Porter. Porter was destined to become one of the naval heroes of the Civil War, but at this point, he was merely a 48-year-old lieutenant, frustrated by the slow rate of promotion in the peacetime service. The son of David Porter, a hero of the War of 1812, he was also the brother of William Porter, another Navy officer, and the foster brother of David Glasgow Farragut. Porter was something of a free spirit in the Navy, a confident, even brash individual who was not averse to self-promotion. Lincoln Secretary John Hay described him as a ready offhand talker with a slight dash of the rowdy. For his part, Welles acknowledged that Porter had dash and energy, but he was concerned that, like Seward, he was given to intrigues. Meigs had been busy promoting Seward's plan to secure Fort Pickens. He even got General Scott to write to the president insisting that it was of prime importance to send a war steamer to Pensacola immediately. Lincoln listened respectfully as Meigs and Porter outlined an impromptu plan in which the steamer Powhatan would act as a screen to prevent interference while 4 to 6 companies of infantry landed at the fort. Lincoln was not averse to the idea. He had not chosen to hold Sumter instead of Pickens. He wanted to hold them both, and he was aware that the one company of soldiers from the Brooklyn that he had ordered into Fort Pickens did not guarantee its security. Lincoln was certainly aware that Seward was running his own game here, especially in the wake of the astonishing memos Seward had handed him that morning. Lincoln must have wondered if this visit was not merely an attempt by Seward to reactivate his plan to reinforce Pickens while sacrificing Sumter. But if both forts could be secured, wasn't that a better outcome? Lincoln quickly consulted the list of ships that Welles had put together, indicating which vessels were to be sent on the Fort Sumter expedition. The Pocahontas, Pawnee, and Harriet Lane, as well as the Baltic, were all listed there, but not the Powhatan. Still, he wanted to make sure that the various elements of his administration were working in unison. "What will Uncle Gideon say?" the president asked. Seward waved off that detail. "I will make it right with Mr. Welles." Lincoln thereupon gave his consent to organize a second expedition, this one to Fort Pickens, and since time was short, Meigs and Porter went into the next room to write the pertinent orders on the spot. Porter wrote one order giving himself command of the Powhatan, and another authorizing the acting commandant of the Brooklyn Navy Yard, Andrew Hull Foote, to prepare that ship for an undisclosed sea duty. Largely because Porter insisted that the fewer people who knew about the mission, the less likely it was that news of it would leak out, that second order also directed that, under no circumstances, was Foote to communicate to the Navy Department the fact that she is fitting out. Similarly, Meigs's order to the commander of the embarked soldiers declared that the object and destination of this expedition will be communicated to no one to whom it is not already known. There was more. Meigs wrote out another order transferring Commodore Stringham from Washington to command the squadron off Pensacola. Welles had previously appointed Stringham to head a new Office of Detail, where his principal job was to vouch for the loyalty of officers being considered for key assignments. Meigs's order now elevated Commodore Samuel Barron to head this new bureau. Porter added a postscript to these orders authorizing Barron to assign officers for special purposes as the exigencies of the service may require, a responsibility that nominally belonged to the Secretary of the Navy. Lincoln signed this order along with the other orders, 6 altogether, as they were brought to him, saying as he did so, "Seward, see that I don't burn my fingers." Lincoln was right to express concern. Under the direction of the Secretary of State, an Army captain and a Navy lieutenant were reorganizing the armed forces of the United States. Lincoln told one of his private secretaries, John Nicolay, to ensure that Welles got copies of the papers, but not all the papers. Seward supported Porter's desire to keep the mission to Pensacola a close secret, and he convinced Lincoln to withhold information about it even from the Navy Department. As a result, Nicolay took to Welles only those papers concerning Stringham's reassignment and Barron's new appointment. That was enough, however, to provoke an instant response from the prickly Navy Secretary. Welles was eating his dinner at Willard's Hotel when Nicolay found him in the dining room and handed him the papers. Welles glanced at them quickly. Greatly alarmed, he threw down his napkin and left at once for the White House. Lincoln was working at his desk when Welles burst in on him. The president looked up to see the bewhiskered Navy Secretary bearing down on him under a full head of steam, clutching a sheaf of papers in his hand and bearing an expression so confrontational that Lincoln impulsively blurted out, "What have I done wrong?" Welles showed him. What Welles found singular and remarkable was not so much Stringham's reassignment to Pensacola, but the elevation of Barron to head a bureau of detail endowed with duties that rivaled those of the Navy Secretary. Welles's alarm was not merely a product of his pique at this challenge to his authority. In these early days of the administration, Welles was paying a lot of attention to the issue of officer loyalty, precisely why he had wanted Stringham by his side, and Barron was one of those officers whom Welles eyed suspiciously. Not only was Barron Southern-born and a vocal champion of the secessionist cause, but he was also a close friend of Jefferson Davis. In Welles's mind, to make such a man responsible for officer assignments was foolish at best, and indeed, Welles's instinct about Barron proved to be correct, for within weeks, Barron would be in Richmond wearing Confederate gray. Lincoln claimed to be surprised that he had signed such an order. The president explained that Seward and two young officers had been there all day writing orders and that he had merely signed the papers as they were presented to him. He had, he told Welles, left the details to Seward and signed the papers without reading them. Welles wanted to know who the two officers were, and Lincoln told him. One was Captain Meigs, and the other was a Navy officer named Porter. Welles suspected at once that Porter had become involved in a palace intrigue for the purpose of elevating his friends within the Navy. Lincoln readily and immediately countermanded the order regarding Barron's assignment, and Welles was momentarily mollified. He thought he had averted a catastrophe by nipping the Seward-Porter plot in the bud. In his journal, he referred to the episode as Seward's Barron conspiracy. But he remained unaware of the Fort Pickens expedition. When Welles asked Lincoln about the broader purpose of Seward's visit, Lincoln told him only that it was a special project of the Secretary of State and that Seward preferred it to be kept secret. Welles let it go. He should have pressed harder, for elevating Barron was only one element, and not the most consequential, of Seward's intrigue. By the evening of April 1, two naval expeditions were being assembled, one for Fort Sumter and one for Fort Pickens, but in the entire country, only four men, the President, the Secretary of State, and two junior officers, were aware of it. Consequently, the flurry of orders sent out that day created as much confusion as direction. The greatest confusion concerned the USS Powhatan, a decade-old sidewheel steamer armed with 10 9-inch Dahlgren guns and one 11-inch pivot. Though the Powhatan was worn down by recent service, it was one of the more powerful vessels in the Navy's small arsenal of steam warships. On the very evening that Porter sat in the White House writing himself orders to command it, Foote at the Brooklyn Navy Yard received a telegram from Welles ordering him to fit out the Powhatan to go to sea at the earliest possible moment. Foote explained by return telegram that the Powhatan had just returned from Veracruz and had been put temporarily out of commission, just that day, as it happened, but that he would immediately recall the officers and crew and try to have it back and ready for service as soon as possible. Then, later that afternoon, Foote received a second telegram, with nearly identical wording from the president himself. Fit out the Powhatan to go to sea at the earliest possible moment under sealed orders. Foote logically assumed that this was a confirmation of Welles's order. In fact, of course, it referred to a completely different expedition. Meanwhile, Fox headed for New York to line up the supplies he would carry to Anderson's garrison in Fort Sumter. At the last minute, the supplier of the desiccated, dehydrated foods backed out, fearful of contributing to the outbreak of war, and Fox had to scramble to obtain substitutes. William Aspinwall, the owner of the Baltic, was similarly concerned, and Fox had to stay up until late into the night on March 30 before Aspinwall finally agreed to let the government charter his ship. Disgusted with such timidity, Fox confided to Blair that the delays, obstacles, and brief time allowed made him heartsick but not discouraged. As the preparations went forward, Lincoln continued with the routine political and social obligations of his office. On April 3, he attended a wedding at the Washington Navy Yard, where the daughter of the yard's commandant, Captain Franklin Buchanan, was marrying a Marine lieutenant, Julius Meyer. Buchanan himself was a Marylander, with strong ties to the slaveholding aristocracy on Maryland's eastern shore, and he and his family were less than thrilled that the tall, gangly president honored them by his appearance. The bride's younger sister, 15-year-old Elizabeth Buchanan, at first refused to shake hands with the new president, but Lincoln cheerfully teased her about being a little rebel, and she eventually relented. In the end, Lincoln escorted the bride into the reception dinner. It was a measure of both the precarious political environment and Lincoln's strategic isolation that, although Buchanan was one of the most senior naval officers in the capital, the president could not mention to him either of the two naval expeditions that were being prepared. That night, Fox returned to the White House to report that he had completed the preliminary arrangements for the expedition to Sumter, and Lincoln gave him his official orders. Fox expressed his concern that the delays he had encountered meant that he might not arrive at Charleston in time. Lincoln shared his concern. Just that day, he had read the latest missive from Anderson, who now reported that instead of holding out until April 15, his supplies would be gone by April 10. Even if everything went on schedule, the expedition could not arrive at Charleston until late on the 11th. But the bit was in his teeth now. He ordered Secretary of War Simon Cameron to tell Anderson to hold out if possible, though it was unlikely the order would reach him in time, and he calmly assured Fox that whatever happened, he should best fulfill his duty by making the attempt. Seward's earlier assurances to Southern representatives that the government would make no attempt to reinforce Sumter without notice put him in an awkward position, and he insisted now that the administration must live up to that pledge. Welles opposed it. After all, he argued, a key element of Fox's expedition was stealth. To notify the secessionists that an expedition was en route jeopardized its potential for success and put Fox and all those who sailed with him in increased peril. Lincoln decided that he would send a notification of the impending mission to South Carolina, but only after the expedition had sailed. The note he sent stated that if local authorities permitted the resupply of Anderson's garrison, the U.S. government would not land any reinforcements, but if they resisted, then both supplies and reinforcements would be landed. It is impossible to know what Lincoln expected such a message to accomplish. He may have genuinely hoped that South Carolina authorities would allow the supplies to be delivered to Anderson. More likely, he calculated that his message might provoke the secessionists to act, and, in acting, assume the burden of the consequences. The next day, April 4, Porter showed up at the Brooklyn Navy Yard with orders signed by Lincoln giving him command of the Powhatan. Foote was perplexed and even suspicious. He wanted to confirm the orders with Welles, but the order signed by Lincoln specified that under no circumstances was he to communicate to the Navy Department the fact that she is fitting out. This was absurd. Of course Welles knew the ship was fitting out. Welles had personally ordered it to be done 4 days earlier and had sent several telegrams since urging Foote to hurry. Briefly, Foote even wondered if Porter were not a Southern sympathizer trying to gain possession of a warship for the Confederacy. Foote did all that he thought he could do under such curious circumstances. He sent Welles a cryptically worded telegram reporting that he had received orders to have certain preparations made and things placed on board of vessels soon to go to sea, but as the orders do not come direct, I make this report." Welles, of course, assumed this was a reference to the Sumter expedition and that everything was proceeding on schedule. Not until late on April 5 did all of the parties involved in this comedy of errors begin to read off the same script, and it was Seward who exposed the confusion. That day, Welles sent final orders to the captains of all four ships assigned to the Sumter mission, including the Powhatan, to rendezvous off Charleston on April 11. From New York, Meigs wired Seward to complain that Welles was interfering with the expedition to Pensacola by sending orders to the Powhatan. Seward suspected that Uncle Gideon was trying to sabotage the expedition, and, determined to get this straightened out, he and his son Fred dashed across Lafayette Park to Welles' home, which was only a few hundred yards away, woke the Navy Secretary from a sound sleep, and demanded to know why he was meddling in Porter's command of the Powhatan. "Surely there was some mistake," Welles told him. "Porter had no such command. Samuel Mercer commanded the Powhatan, which was the flagship of the expedition to Fort Sumter." "Not so," Seward declared. "The Powhatan was ordered to Fort Pickens under Porter's command." Welles very nearly lost his temper. He admitted in his diary that his conversation included some excitement on my part. Only one person could resolve the dispute, and together the two cabinet secretaries and young Fred recrossed Lafayette Square to the White House to wake up Lincoln, even though it was nearly midnight. Lincoln wasn't asleep. He heard both men, and at first he sided with Seward, declaring that the Powhatan was not part of the Sumter expedition. The sputtering Welles was sure that it was. He charged off to his office to get copies of the orders and soon returned with the evidence. Once he read them to the president, Lincoln recalled having approved them, and he declared that since Sumter was the more important objective, the Powhatan must be reassigned to that duty. He told both men that he had approved of sending the ship to Fort Pickens in the first place only because it was not on the original list of vessels destined for Charleston. Now that he knew better, he told Seward to relieve Porter from command of the Powhatan and return it to Captain Mercer. Welles later recalled that Mr. Seward remarked to me that, old as he was, he had learned a lesson from this experience, which was that he had better attend to his own business, not interfere with others, and confine his labors to his proper department. Savoring his rare triumph over the Secretary of State, Welles dryly added, "To this I cordially assented." But the comedy of errors had one more act. It was past midnight by the time the fate of the Powhatan was resolved, too late to send a telegram that night. Earlier that evening, Welles had taken the precaution of wiring Foote to delay the Powhatan for further instructions. Now that order seemed providential, for it would keep the disputed vessel in port until Seward's clarifying orders could arrive the next day. Such an assumption overlooked Porter's dash and energy. When he received Welles's delay order, Porter's first reaction was anger. He told Meigs that he would do nothing more for this government. He would go to California and spend his time surveying. Meigs tried to calm him down, suggesting that the order was probably bogus. It seemed unlikely to him that Welles would dare to countermand an order, written order, of the president. In a kind of compromise, Meigs sailed that night on the steamer Atlantic with his four infantry companies, and Porter agreed to wait until morning. If he did not receive new orders from the president by then, he would carry out his mission. When Porter awoke at 6 o'clock the next morning, no new orders had arrived. If he had an opportunity to glance at the morning's New York Times as he headed for the Navy Yard, he might have read a headline that proved that Seward's concerns about secrecy were well-founded. The impending crisis, threat to bombard Sumter in 48 hours, the Powhatan to sail immediately. Porter rowed out to the Powhatan, ordered the crew to get up steam, and at 2:30 that afternoon, the Powhatan left New York Harbor bound for Pensacola. A half hour later, at 3 o'clock, Seward's telegram arrived at the Navy Yard ordering Porter to give up the Powhatan to Captain Mercer. Foote sent a fast tug in pursuit of the Powhatan, and it caught up with the steamer in the New York Narrows, where it had paused to drop off Captain Mercer. Foote's messenger climbed aboard and handed Seward's telegram to Porter. Porter now had to do some swift thinking. He noted that the telegram was signed Seward. But Porter had orders in his pocket, orders of whose provenance he was certain since he had written them himself, that were signed by the President. Seward's order was more recent, to be sure, but could the Secretary of State countermand orders from the Chief Executive? Another consideration was that if he complied with this order and returned to port, Meigs's four companies of infantry, already en route, would arrive at Fort Pickens without their naval support and without their artillery, which was stowed in the hold of the Powhatan. Porter knew that his mission had been planned in the White House, and despite the orders from both Welles and Seward, he still had not heard from Lincoln. Porter acknowledged his predicament to Foote. "This is an unpleasant position to be in," he wrote. "The President says nothing, and I must obey his orders. They are too explicit to be misunderstood. I got them from his own hand. He has not recalled them." Porter was certainly aware that his decision here would affect not only his career, but also his honor. In the end, however, he characteristically determined that it was better to err on the side of action than that of caution. "Am sustained by my sense of duty," he wrote to Foote, "and will leave the rest of that kind of providence which has never deserted me in very trying circumstances." He delivered the note to Foote's emissary along with a brusque telegram to Seward, reading, "I received my orders from the President and shall proceed and execute them." Then, after the tug cast off, he ordered the engine room to go ahead full. At almost the same moment that Porter and the Powhatan steamed out of New York, Welles received a secret confidential communication from Captain Henry Adams, the officer commanding the U.S. Navy squadron off Pensacola. It had been hand-carried to Washington by Lieutenant Washington Guathme, a Southern sympathizer who would spend the war in a Confederate uniform, but who dutifully delivered Adams's communication before resigning. In this message, Adams declared his painful embarrassment in reporting that despite the orders sent to him in March to land the troops on the Brooklyn at Fort Pickens, he had not done so. His justification was that back in January, the government and the secessionists at Pensacola had agreed to a truce. The secessionists had promised not to attack Fort Pickens if the U.S. government pledged itself not to land any reinforcements, and the Buchanan administration had ordered Adams not to land the company on board the Brooklyn unless said fort shall be attacked. Lincoln's March 11 order to land the troops had arrived, but it bore the signature of the Army's Adjutant General, Edward Townsend. Once again, the strict separation of departments allowed a Navy officer to question the validity of an order from Washington. Adams decided that, absent a confirming order from the Navy Department, orders from the Army's Adjutant General were not enough to compel him to an act that might provoke civil war. "Such a step is too important to be taken without the clearest orders from proper authority," he wrote. Like Anderson, Adams did not want the responsibility of starting a civil war. Welles at once took the news to Lincoln. Here was another complication to an already complicated situation, and the implications of Adams's timorousness became dire once Lincoln learned that Porter and the Powhatan were bound for Fort Pickens after all. To be sure, there was little doubt that Porter would do what Adams would not, reinforce Pickens, but the Powhatan could not arrive there for at least 10 days. In fact, it took 11, and in the meantime, Fort Pickens was bereft of infantry support. Once the secessionists in Pensacola learned of the expedition to Sumter, they might decide to assault Fort Pickens, and without the additional reinforcements, their assault might well succeed. If the Sumter expedition failed because the Powhatan was dispatched elsewhere and Pickens fell because a punctilious Navy captain would not obey orders, both forts would be lost and the government's policy would be in shambles. Lincoln and Welles agreed that they would have to send a special messenger by train with peremptory orders for Adams to land the troops at once. Who was available for such a mission? Whoever it was would have to be found and instructed quickly, for it was already late in the afternoon, and the evening steamer across the Potomac left at 7 o'clock. The man Welles chose was Lieutenant John L. Worden, a 43-year-old scientific officer who had spent most of his career at the Naval Observatory. The suspicious Welles was satisfied that Worden was untainted by treason, and after writing out orders in his own hand for Adams to land the troops at Fort Pickens immediately, he required Worden to memorize them so that if he was searched and had to destroy them, he might recite them from memory. That night, as the Powhatan steamed southward along the Jersey coast and Worden's train rumbled through Virginia en route to Pensacola, Fox was having trouble getting out of New York Harbor. The officers on one of the tugs refused to leave, fearing that they were being sent into harm's way. Then the deep-draft chartered steamer Baltic failed to get over the bar outside New York Harbor on April 8, and Fox had to anchor overnight, hoping to get out with the morning tide. He fumed at the delay, writing his wife, "I am afraid we are too late." When the Baltic finally did get to sea on the morning of April 9, it encountered a gale that buffeted the ship throughout its passage. For most of 4 excruciating days, the 200 soldiers below deck suffered horrible seasickness before the Baltic finally arrived at the rendezvous coordinates 10 miles off Charleston at 3 o'clock in the morning on April 12. The only other vessel in sight was the Harriet Lane, though the Pawnee arrived a few hours later. There was no sign of the tugs, the Pocahontas, or, of course, the Powhatan. Fox went on board the Pawnee and asked its captain, Stephen C. Rowan, what support he could provide. Rowan offered him the Pawnee's launch and cutter, hardly satisfactory replacements for 3 steam tugs, but apparently all that was immediately available. Fox returned to the Baltic to conduct a reconnaissance of the harbor entrance. As the Baltic approached the shoreline, Fox heard the rumbling growl of artillery fire and soon saw, with horror, that shells were exploding above the ramparts of Fort Sumter. As he had feared, he was too late. As Fox headed back out, he met the Pawnee coming in. Rowan, too, had heard the firing, and he announced his determination of sharing the fate of his brethren of the army, though he lacked a pilot who could take him in. Fox took it upon himself to speak for the administration in saying that the government wanted no unnecessary loss of life, such as would certainly result from such a noble but hopeless gesture. The Confederate decision to open fire on Fort Sumter that morning had been triggered not by the arrival of the Baltic, but by the note that Lincoln had sent to South Carolina's governor, Francis Pickens. It had arrived on April 8, and Pickens passed it on to Brigadier General Pierre G.T. Beauregard, who in turn passed it to the Confederate government in Montgomery. In the end, it was Jefferson Davis who made the decision not to allow Sumter to be reinforced or resupplied. He ordered Beauregard to demand the immediate surrender of the fort, and if Anderson refused, the general was to reduce it by gunfire. The first shot was fired just minutes after the Baltic reached the rendezvous point, 10 miles offshore. In spite of the bombardment, Fox still hoped to send supplies and reinforcements into the harbor once it was dark enough. The problem was that none of the tugs had arrived, for they had been thwarted by the same storm that had buffeted the Baltic. Fox was sure that the Powhatan would arrive during the night, and so he took the Baltic out to the appointed rendezvous and made signals all night. There was no answer, of course, and the next morning, desperate to do something, Fox prepared to load the 16 boats he carried on the Baltic with the embarked soldiers and accompany them on the long pull into the fort, though the continuing severe weather made that a daunting prospect. Rowan had a better idea. On his own authority, he seized a privately owned schooner that was bringing a cargo of ice to Charleston and offered that vessel to Fox. While the ice boat was being prepared, a cloud of heavy black smoke roiled up from Sumter, and it was evident that something in the fort, most likely the barracks, was on fire. Soon afterward, the USS Pocahontas arrived off Charleston, and Commander John Gillis assumed responsibility as senior officer present. While Fox and Rowan briefed Gillis on the situation, the firing in the harbor suddenly stopped, and lookouts reported that the American flag was no longer flying over the fort. Gillis sent in a party with a flag of truce, which returned with the news that Anderson had surrendered. On April 15, Robert Anderson and his garrison evacuated Fort Sumter and joined their would-be rescuers aboard the Baltic. They had occupied the most famous fort in America for 108 days, commanding the attention of the entire nation, including its new president. Though they had endured a lengthy siege and a two-day bombardment before capitulating, not a single member of the garrison, astonishingly, had been killed in all that furious cannonade. Anderson had made it a condition of his surrender that he be allowed to fire a salute to the flag before he departed. He intended to fire 100 guns, but around the 50th shot, one of the fort's guns went off prematurely, killing a simple-minded 35-year-old private named Daniel Huff, the first of some 620,000 mortal casualties of the American Civil War. On the same day that the Baltic appeared off Charleston, Lieutenant Worden arrived at the train station in Pensacola. En route from Atlanta, the cars were filled with Confederate soldiers, who taunted him with the promise that he would be arrested as soon as they arrived in Pensacola. Worden went into the water closet, opened, read, and destroyed the dispatch he was carrying. Once in Pensacola, he obtained permission from local authorities to go out to see Adams, to whom he delivered Lincoln's order to land the soldiers now on board the USS Sabine, who had come out some 5 months before on the Brooklyn. This time, Adams obeyed, landing 86 soldiers and 115 Marines to reinforce the garrison of 83 men already in the fort. The secessionists in Pensacola were furious and insisted that the move was not only a violation of their agreement, but also an act of treachery. It might have started a war if war had not already begun that morning at Fort Sumter. Having completed his mission, Worden rather foolishly went ashore and boarded a train for the return trip to Washington. He made it as far as Montgomery before he was arrested by Confederate authorities and confined as a prisoner of war. 5 days later, the Powhatan steamed into sight off Pensacola. En route south, Porter had ordered the crew to paint over the gun ports and make other changes to disguise the Powhatan as a mail steamer. He planned to steam past the rebel forts directly into the harbor and dare the locals to try to stop him. Unlike either Anderson or Adams, Porter was perfectly willing to start a war. As he wrote later, "I thought it was time to be firing bullets." As he steamed toward the harbor, however, he found himself cut off by the USS Wyandotte with Meigs on board, signaling furiously. Meigs had arrived the day before on the Atlantic, and after a conversation with the local army commander, he became convinced that the 284 men now in the fort were more than adequate to defend it, and that a further hostile act now would be counterproductive. He urged Porter to put off the day of collision as long as possible. Porter was annoyed. He asked Meigs to put his request in writing, and Meigs did so. "My connection with the expedition," Meigs wrote, "justify me in making the request with almost the force of an order from the president." Porter grudgingly acquiesced, but he declared his readiness to enter the port and challenge the rebel batteries at a moment's notice. In a prosaic anticlimax, the Powhatan...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.